He's been a business consultant with Compeer Financial in the States since 2012. In this role, Matt provides his clients with a lot: production and financial management expertise, assisting them with annual budget projections, ongoing performance monitoring, strategic planning, benchmarking, tactical decision making and analysis. Sounds a lot, but it's switched on stuff. The Compeer Dairy Consulting team operates within around about 100 dairy producers, over 80,000 cows in their data set. Matt holds an MS in Agricultural Economics from Purdue University, an MBA from Indiana University, and resides in Menominee in Wisconsin with his wife and twin daughters. Can I have a warm welcome for Matt Lange.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me here. This is my second time to the UK. I was here in 2015. And at that point in time, you guys were going through some pretty tough times. Milk prices were down a little bit at that point in time. And really since then in the US, in 2014, we had our best year ever. So I was coming off of a high. I thought I was a brilliant dairy consultant, making my clients all this money. It was really just the milk price being higher. But then came here, learned what you guys were doing, where the milk price was at, and actually going back to the US, that's kind of what has happened to us. So we're gonna take a little bit look at, see what has happened in the United States over the last couple of years. I wanna give you a little bit of perspective, just kind of from the US as to what our dairy producers are seeing. I've graphed out here the milk price for, well, all the way back to 1980s, okay? What do we notice? These bars represent the price per hundredweight that our dairy producers are receiving. What do you notice about it? Kind of go up and down, right? So down a little bit over here. We get some highs, but we also get some lows. What's interesting is I actually graphed this line, which represents the percent change year over year of the milk price. What do we notice about that? Absolutely, we have greater volatility, right? We may have a great year one year, and then the next year, milk price goes down, right? So this volatility is created in part because of a changing dynamic on the global scene. The United States has become much more of a player on the export market. We still only export maybe 15 to 17% of our production, which isn't necessarily a whole lot. Compared to, say, New Zealand or Holland, that exports a greater amount. But in 2009, when we had a huge dip right here, catastrophic in the United States, exports really only changed about 2 to 3%. That was a big contributing factor to why the milk price went down, right? So the story behind the story, what happens when we get this greater volatility? The greater volatility sometimes doesn't allow us to be able to get through the downtimes, right? We can have a really good year in 2014, get hit hard in 2015, and actually be out of business, right? So we have greater heightened risk of unrecoverable losses. We have greater consolidation in the United States. It's consistent. So in my home state of Wisconsin, we lose on average 500 dairy farms a year. 10 years ago, we had about 15,000 dairy farms. We're under 10,000 today. So we've lost about 5,000 dairy farms. But guess what? Cow numbers are going up. Milk production per cow is going up, right? So we're getting larger farms. The average herd size in our benchmark is 1,200 cows. So we cover a pretty broad spectrum of dairies. We work with dairies that have 25 cows. My largest herd that I've worked with is about 4,300 cows. Okay, so it's a very broad spectrum of what types of dairies we have. So let's take a look and see performance-wise. Now I've tried my best to convert everything. You know, it'd be great if the US just went on a metric system like the rest of the world. It would have saved me a whole lot of time trying to convert all the stuff over. So just want to give you a little bit of perspective as to what is the United States, how do they compare with milk production and some of these other attributes. So notice, on average, the herds in our benchmark, about 37 liters per cow per day. Not tremendous. We do have herds that are pushing 45, 46 liters per cow per day, and some that are less. What do you notice here, though? All right? So even though milk per cow per day has stayed pretty level, we do see a slight increase in energy-corrected milk. So in energy-corrected milk, we're standardizing milk production back to a 3-0 protein and a 3-5 fat, okay? So that means if I have a herd that's producing a 4-0 fat and a 3-5 protein, I'm shipping potentially more than my neighbor is, right? So when we're standardizing it back, most of our herds are increasing the amount of protein and butterfat that they're shipping. Why? Because our processors are paying us for it. They've encouraged us. The world market wants more components. So we've tried to deliver on that. What's interesting is you look at this overall, both energy corrected and pure pounds have stayed pretty consistent, even though, look at our milk price. In 13, we were 35 pence a liter. Then we went to 41. Man, those were good times. Really loved that year. Then we dropped down to 30 pence a liter. Last year, we were 28. And the first half of this year so far, we're at 30 pence. Now, I know for you guys, you might say, hey, that sounds pretty good. But you have to remember, our cost of production in the United States is a bit higher. Okay? So we're going to look at what the impact is. Marketing gains or losses. So, you know, in the U.S., we can contract, much like you guys can, with a processor. Set a price, and we're going to sell the milk to the processor at that price. We also have a futures market in the U.S. I was here 2 years ago, and I advocated the U.K. try to move to a futures market-based system. Okay, so if I look out in the futures market, 4 times in the U.S. this year, milk prices approached $17 a hundredweight. Okay, now I know that, convert it back, but just stay with me. $17 a hundredweight, okay? The average for this year now is probably going to pan out to about $16 a hundredweight. So there are 4 times a dairy farmer could have said, you know what, I see September, October, November, December, $17. I want to buy the right to sell my milk at that price. A lot of farmers didn't take that. Right? We could have actually made money doing that, but now they're going to receive whatever the spot market price is. So in 2014, I had some clients that were very angry because they said, Matt, you told me to market my milk, and I did, and I left money on the table. I took 2 pence a liter off my milk price. I said, yeah, but look, you made 41 pence. Who cares? You made money, right? Then they said, fine, we're never going to do that again. So the farms that never did again took a loss the next year because they didn't. These farms, on average, were able to get a gain, right? The guys that were smart enough to say, I'm going to continue with my marketing strategy, and they protected their milk going into 2015, in some cases made an extra pence a liter. In some cases, did really well and made a pence and a half a liter. You understand they're going forward and really trying to mitigate the risk. Yeah, we gave up 2 pence a liter here, but what was important is I was able to cash flow my business the next 2 years by getting just a little bit more milk or getting a little bit more better pay price. In the United States, everyone thinks we get subsidies. Nah, not really. Not in the dairy side so much anymore. We have insurance programs, but the last few years haven't actually been bad enough to get the insurance value back out of it, right? It's like your house burning down, but it didn't burn down enough to actually, capture an insurance value off it. It's kind of crazy, but that's how it works. Here's what's interesting, right? Components, so our protein and butter fat, the amount that we've made, certainly great value here. You know, 4.5, almost 5 pence a liter, dropped down to threes. We're seeing twos now, right? So it's interesting, processors have said we want more components, but what's interesting is in the United States, certain processors don't necessarily have to pay you for that, right? So we've seen the net effect of a lowering milk price. So let's take a look at cost of production in the United States. So as Tom said, we've got roughly 82,000 cows in our benchmark. Take a look at where feed costs are at, where all of our costs are at, really, as compared to the UK. So feed cost, 21 pence a liter back in 2013, 21 again in 14. Well, we dropped a little bit in 15. 2016 average was 16 pence a liter. top 25% actually weren't really that much different, right? So the top 25% that made money, their feed cost wasn't really any lower than the average. That's interesting, right? In 2017, we're getting down to 15 here now. So remember, this is not just the purchased feed. This is something that I challenge my nutritionist back home, and I would challenge producers and nutritionists here. Okay, it's not just what you buy, it's the feed that you grow. We have to put a value on the forages, right? So in what we do is we'll standardize the feed. So if you harvest silage at 30% dry matter and you harvest your silage at 35% dry matter, we may be standardizing both to 32% dry matter. They're both then on the same level. We can compare your feed cost to your feed cost. And we assign a value. That's what's occurring mostly through here, right? Because corn, this is the opportunity cost of us growing corn and soybeans. So prices were very high on those commodities back in the day, and they're not so high now, so the value of that opportunity has come down, okay? Plus, there are dairy producers that we've been focusing more on forage quality and getting more out of that, trying to increase the percent are our forages in the ration. What's interesting, I looked at a number of clients back here the other day, about 48% of the ration was forages. Today, I see guys pushing 55, 56, 57% forages, right? Trying to get more out of what we're growing and what we're producing. Labor costs, we'll talk more about feed in a little bit. Labor cost, here's what I love. 2014, you guys know that was a great year for us, right? Guess what happened? We made money. You get a raise. You get a raise. You get a raise. Everyone gets a raise. What's the problem with giving raises? Yes. No one's going to say, you know what, Mr. Farmer, you're having a hard time. Just pay me less. No. So when people talk about lowering labor costs, I don't know what they're talking about. How are we going to lower labor costs? Right? So we gave a lot of raises. You know, we paid a little bit more. Have we really lowered it? Yeah, we've tried. How do you lower labor cost? Well, you try to become more efficient. Maybe you do with one less employee that you kept around to help out when another employee left or something like that. So we're doing little things like that to be more efficient, more productive, but really, has it come down much? Now, the top 25% are keeping it at about 5 pence a liter, okay? So if you have a great idea of how to lower that labor cost other than putting robots in, let me know, okay? Because I don't see this changing much for the world. Net herd replacement cost. Now this is a little bit of a different concept. So if I have a value of an animal on my farm, a mature cow at 1,200 pounds, and I go and cull her and I get, say, 500 pounds for her, I got 500 pounds cash, right? I got to put that in my back pocket. But what did I actually do? She was valued at 1,200, and I sold her for five. I lost 700 pounds, right? Now, if I do that another time, I lost 1,400, right? I do it a third time, now I lost 2,100, right? This is when we look at cull rates in the U.S., or at least with our herds, we're focusing on net herd replacement cost. The value difference between you culling an animal, her cull value versus what she was valued on the farm. So as cull rates go up, so does your net herd replacement cost. What also affects this? Cull values. Everybody talks about the great milk prices we had. You know what? We got great value for our cull cows. There was a time in 2014 where a dairy producer could ship a cull cow to market, fill the trailer up with a fresh cow, drive it back to the farm, and not owe anybody much money. I heard what some of your cull prices are here. I thought about collecting all the cull cows in the U.S., bringing them over on a boat and dumping them off here and collecting your price, right? Cull values for you guys are very strong right now as compared to the U.S. The U.S. right now, we're maybe getting about 300 pounds per cull cow, 400 pounds maybe on the top end. So not very much, right? So that's where we come back here. This was a very low cost because we had good, strong call values, right? Capital cost. There's only three things that go into capital cost: depreciation, interest, and leases. Leases are becoming much more popular in the US. Try to mitigate what we're borrowing on the balance sheet, what we have to borrow from the bank, versus just leasing the piece of equipment, using it, and turning it back in. Okay? So you notice in 2014, all of a sudden we went up to 4 pence a liter. What happened? What happened? There's a joke in the US and it says if you put $2 in a dairy producer's pocket, they'll spend $4, right? That's right. Milk price was great, so producers decided to take that additional capital that they made and reinvest it back in the business, which in turn means you're going to have a little bit more depreciation and maybe you had to borrow a little money too. Okay? One of the worst comments I ever hear from accountants is, you're going to have to pay taxes this year, so you better go out and buy something. No! No, do not do that. Okay? Because what happens is next year the milk price goes down and you still got to pay for it. What's that? That's right. Buy the things you need. Absolutely. So, it depends who you are on that first question. Is Donald Trump good or bad news for the dairy farmer in America? You know, actually, it is a good question. We could talk probably the next 3 hours about this. He's both-sided, in my opinion, because we obviously have some immigration issues in the U.S. I don't know that they will be resolved, but one of the biggest challenges why labor cost has gone up is because we're very short of labor in the U.S. We struggle. Dairy producers are almost held captive to their employees. The employee says, I want a raise today, or I'm not showing up to milk. More often than not, we give them the raise. So if we don't have that labor source in the short term, what are we going to do? So I'm very concerned about President Trump's policy on that. But at the same time, if we can work out better international agreements and better trade negotiations, we might get more value for our product on the global market as well. Are there any things particular in the U.S. dairy sector that simply don't apply or matter in the U.K.? I don't know. You know, it's interesting. I've been across the globe. I've been to, when my family goes on vacation, my wife knows that I'm going to find a way to make it to a dairy farm somewhere. It just becomes part of the family vacation. And so, you know, I've been to a lot of dairies in a lot of different parts of the world. And one thing that is true is a lot of things are very consistent between cultures and between ethnic groups. And so I think there's a lot in the U.S. that does apply. How is dairying sustainable when in the U.S. you are losing money more than you? Yeah, that's a very good question. So a lot of times it comes back to what I'm telling a lot of my struggling dairy producers is this is a waiting game, right? We have to maybe restructure debt or we have to find ways to liquidate assets to bring in cash flow. We need to extend more debt out there. To keep things going with the anticipation that the market's going to come back. Usually that can last about 2.5 years, maybe 3 years at most, which means if we're going on 3 years of losses, we'll be seeing more dairy producers go out in the U.S. in the next coming months, right? Let's take a couple other ones here. So capital cost. So I just want to make a point here. We talked about that going up in 2014. But this is a good connection here. Why did it go up in 2016? We didn't get paid very well in 16, but all of a sudden this capital cost went up real high. Remember, I said depreciation. There weren't a lot of big projects. Interest and leases. Interest, right? Interest rates went up, but also halfway through 2016, producers started saying, I don't have any money. I gotta go, Mr. Banker, can I borrow some money from you so I can finance my losses? That's my fear right here, folks, is when I have a loss and I have to go to the bank to borrow the money to finance the loss, I have fixed that cost. That doesn't become a variable cost anymore. I have fixed it permanently for the next 5 to 7 years or however long it's going to take me to pay it back down, right? That's a huge concern that I have for a number of dairies throughout the U.S. Other production costs, it's pretty consistent. It depends on the year, how much we're paying here or there, but that's fairly consistent. So at the end of the day, whole cost farm of production, 32 pence. You know what's interesting is as milk price goes up, our cost of production goes up, right? We find a way to spend more money. And when it goes down, well, we find a way to try to get it down further. So what happened? 2013, 2.5 pence a liter. 2014, like we talked about, we made good money there. Here we are. So far, 2015, not so good. 16, not so good. 17's not so good. I've done a few budgets for 2018 already. Looks about the same as 2016. Now, that's not to say we don't have dairies that haven't made money. Certainly, our top 25% have found a way to make a 3 or 4% return on their investment in the dairy over the last 5 to 6 years. So there are dairy producers that are making money. Is a farm consultant worth the investment? Well, of course he's worth the investment. Actually, that is a good question. You know, I do think you can do it. I think a lot of my clients would say, you know, I don't know that I necessarily bring a great deal of new vision or grand solutions to them, but they don't have a lot of the time to do the hard analysis and provide some of the solutions on the front end of how to make more money. That's kind of what they pay me for. So do I think it's worth it? I think you have to ask yourself, what do I want to get out of it? Simply just hiring somebody, just because your neighbor's done it or maybe they do it in the U.S., that doesn't help you. You know, that's like these guys were saying the other day, well, how do we design a barn? Well, we went and looked at our neighbor's barn and we copied it. Yeah, but should we really be copying our barn, the neighbor's barn, or should we be building a better barn, right? It's what's our vision? What are we going to get out of it? What and why are the higher costs of production in the U.S. compared to the U.K. and EU? Yeah, so I think most of it, I know as you guys look at feed cost does appear to be higher. I would also challenge you, most of you guys are probably just looking at your purchased feed cost. And I think you need to spend more time looking at what is our forage value cost along with our purchase, because I bet you'd be pretty surprised. I'd be curious. I bet you come very close to what we're in the U.S. What else? Probably labor. I think you guys utilize a lot more family labor than we do in the United States, especially with the size of the operations. We have to hire more labor. Probably capital costs. You guys usually pay back your debt a little bit quicker than we do because of how the debt is structured, so we carry more debt on our farms. I would say those are probably the big key things. So how much money do we make on a per cow basis? You can see here, 313 pounds. Look at that, 832. Since then, we've been less. Return on equity. So occasionally I get to work with some investors, which is a growing trend of financing in the United States. So I had a chance to talk to some Chinese investors. Matt, we have $300-400 million. We want to invest in U.S. ag. We want, we want to do something. What should we do? Well, what do you want for your return? Well, about 10 to 12% equity. Yeah, I can do that 1 year out of five for you. How's that work? Yeah, that doesn't work so good, right? That's partially because of the volatility that we see. But the very best farms are still finding a way to get that 3 or 4%, and that's usually the average in the U.S. Working capital. These two metrics here, to me, are some of the most important metrics that I look at, and your banker probably looks at. Working capital, right? The lifeblood of our farm. Current assets, which are cash, receivables, like things I've produced but I haven't gotten paid for yet, right? I produced milk this month, I get the milk check next month, right? So cash, milk receivables, other receivables, and feed inventory. I add all that up, I subtract off my liabilities, current liabilities. Operating loan, payables, right? Bills that I've got but I haven't paid for yet. And current portion, which is something related to what is my principal and interest payments for the next 12 months. When I add those up and I subtract them from my current assets, This is what I'm left on a per cow basis. My target for the UK would be at least 300 pounds. For the United States, our clients, we target 400 pounds per cow. I feel more comfortable, honestly, having 600 US dollars per cow, which would put you guys closer to about 500. That is the lifeblood. That tells me how I'm going to be able to finance my short-term needs for the farm. The other thing your banker looks at is capital debt repayment capacity. This is the difference of, okay, I take my income statement for this year or this month, I add everything up on an accrual basis. Now I've got depreciation. I'm not gonna count that in, so I take depreciation out. What's my net income? Well, I still got interest expense in there, so I'm gonna take that out, okay? So now I look at my net income without depreciation and interest. Now I divide that into what are my principal and interest payments for that period. So if it's a year, what was my total principal and interest for the period? My goal is 100%, because at 100%, I've paid all my operating expenses and I've serviced my debt, okay? So if I'm at, our target for US clients is about 120. What that means is you've paid all your debt, you've serviced all your operating expenses, and you got 20% left over for depreciation and reinvestment back into the business, right? So where have we been? 151, 253, oh man. So what's happening? The banks are, you're not even keeping up with your operating expenses or your debt. You may have to pay all your operating expenses, but then you're not paying us. Or you're paying us, but you're not keeping up with your bills, okay? So in times of turbulence, the biggest danger is to act with yesterday's logic. Peter Drucker, very famous writer, book author for business books. I think it really talks to us about how do we get through this time. And even though your milk prices are better right now, I think we need to talk about how do we continue to drive profit. Are U.S. farmers concerned about sourcing affordable labor? Yes, 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 yes. Number one concern, when I go to a farm, that's the number one thing that I'm hearing all the time. What are current interest rates in the U.S.? It depends what you're looking at. So if you want something like a 7-year loan for something, it's probably about 5.65%, 5.5% interest. They have come up. Our Federal Reserve has tried to stem inflation, keep inflation low by raising interest rates. Should someone on a farm, big units, go and get economics degree? Yeah, I do believe it. A lot of my clients, here's something that I'm gonna say to this. Your children do not deserve the right to come back. They have to earn the right to come back to the farm. They have to earn the right. When someone that I'm working with says, hey, our son's gonna come back, first question I say, great. How's he going to provide value to this business? That's great that he's here. I'm glad that you as a family can work together. But how is he going to add value? Just showing up and collecting a paycheck is not going to work, right? A lot of my clients require their sons and daughters to go and work for another farmer before they come back home and work for them. Why? Because they want to know, I want you to see someone do it differently. We may not be doing it the right way. Go work for someone else and experience something different. So an economics degree, absolutely. I think that's more important than necessarily going for dairy science, okay? Which country should be watching as a threat compared to the UK? Well, I think the United States is always one. I wouldn't even worry so much about a threat or competitor, honestly. Focus on what you guys do best because, yeah, you want to maybe grow your market, increase the global presence you have on the dairy scene, but at the same time, it means to do that, you have to focus on doing what you do on a daily basis really well, okay? So here's a great thing. So we did a project. We took all of our data. We put it into a system with a Zoetis. We did a project with them, 10 years of data. Aggregated, so no one knew which producer was who, and we basically wanted to answer the question, what makes profitable farms profitable? Somatic cell counts, top third most profitable herds, had 196,000 somatic cell count on average as compared to the bottom third. Now, 196 is actually still pretty high for some of the top 25%. Top 25%, we see a lot of guys even below 100,000. Average, I say, is probably 125 to 150, somewhere in there. But what does this tell us? What does somatic cell counts tell us about our herd? How healthy it is, right? That's 100% of what this is telling us. The healthier the herd, the more profitable it is. That correlation was incredibly strong, right? And what does that come back to? It comes back to cow comfort. It comes back to good quality forages and putting the value into that. Can the owner of the vehicle, I'll let you guys handle that one. And Brexit, good or bad, I will let you guys handle that one as well. I don't know about that one. That's a good question, actually. The Brexit, politics are just, it's like sausage making, right? That's what they say about politics in the U.S. is you never want to watch it being made, right? It's just really not good. So I'm going to skip that one and just continue on with my presentation here. Energy-corrected milk, right? Quality as well as pounds of combined fat and protein. Actually, in the U.S., I don't spend much time looking at percent fat or percent protein anymore. It doesn't tell me anything. Because you could be producing at 35 liters, and you're producing at 45 liters, and you say, well, I have a 4.0 fat, and he says, well, I have a 3.8 fat. He's still shipping more pounds of fat than you are, right? It's about the combined pounds of fat and protein, or in your case, the combined pounds or combined kilos of fat and protein that matter. That's what you're getting paid on. Percent doesn't matter. So we need, and in the U.S., those that were shipping higher quality milk as well as more components in a higher milk production, that generated profitability. Death losses. If you get nothing else out of this, please get this. I want you all to raise your hand with me. Come on, let's do it. And repeat after me. I will not have dead cows. Very good, very good. Dead cows are incredibly, incredibly costly in the United States, as well as here. They're costly for farms, right? Because every time, I want all of my clients, all of my producers, all of you guys and all of your employees, when they walk past the dead cow, I want them to look at her and say, I've just lost 1,500 pounds. Not only that, but I've also lost another 500 pounds in terms of value that I could have kept or could have created with her if she was still alive, right? Dead cows are incredibly costly. The United States average is probably about 6%, somewhere in their death loss. Our top 25% are finding ways to get down to 3%. I met a producer the other day, excellent, 1% death loss, right? We gotta be able to cull animals before they die, if that's the case, right? Death loss is a part of a decision as to how are we culling our animals before they die. What else we got? Net herd replacement cost. We touched a little bit on this. I'm going to hit on a few other points first. Preg rates, right? We've really made a huge investment in the U.S. across a lot of our herds to improve pregnancy rates. So, on the average, the U.S. is still probably in that 20 to 21% preg rates currently. But those herds that are going from an 18 to a 21 or a 20% preg rate, in some cases are going to see about 40 more pounds of profit per cow per year, right? It's about getting cows pregnant quicker and more efficiently. I always ask services per conception. Why? Because every time I do this, it costs me money, right? We've got to be very efficient and cost-effective. Services per conception, I'd say the average is probably about 3 in the U.S., maybe 3.2. Some of my best herds are right around 2, 2.1. I've heard some guys here talk about 1.8, 1.7. That's great. That's fantastic. Okay? What else? Heifer survival. So probably the U.S. is still in that, I don't know, 10 to 15 range, depends. Top 25% are losing about 5 to 7% of their heifers. Right, think about it. We get a cow bred. She carries that calf for 9 months, gives birth. Now we invest all that money in a calf, and we get her to maybe 12 months, and then she dies. Wow, that's very costly, right? We've just wasted a year and a half, almost 2 years of an investment gone like that. We've got to get these heifer survival rates to improve. So here's something that you've talked about. Lifetime value, I agree with his numbers. This is looking at average. So he was looking at the top producing cows. And for us, what is this telling us? This tells us we don't start making money till the fourth or fifth lactation, right? In the United States, it takes 14,000 liters of milk to cover the heifer rearing expense. How many are getting 14,000 liters in the first lactation? Not many, right? So that means we are halfway through the second lactation before we've even covered the heifer cost. Then we still got to cover the first lactation cost. So when we're calling animals before that fourth or fifth lactation, we're really not making a great deal of increased profit continually over those animals. And what's worse, the worst thing I just absolutely hate, we get an animal maybe out here somewhere. She freshens in again, and then within 60 days, we have an involuntary cull. Every time we cull an animal within that first 60 days involuntarily, we haven't even covered our dry period cost, right? No more than 3% on first lactation animals should be our involuntary cull rate. And second lactation and beyond, no more than 5 to 6% removal on involuntary. Now, if someone comes to you and they want to, you know, give you 3,000 pounds for, oh, yeah, sell. Hell, sell them all, right? That's fine. So we've done a lot of work with genomics in the United States. How many of you are genetically testing, genomically testing? Anybody? Good, okay. A few of you are. Okay, so what was interesting in this study that we did was looking at heifers and heifer genetic merit. So how many of you believe your heifers are better genetically than your average cows? This is where everybody says, yes, yes, our heifers are better. Okay, that's the right answer. But what was interesting is in this study, we found out that 23% of our heifers are genetically inferior to our average cow. Almost a quarter of our heifers, even though the average, 4 years of college, a lot of drinking. The only thing I remember from statistics is averages will kill you. Okay? So averages, yes, our heifers are better, but yet we still have 23% in this study that were below our average. So my question is, why are they here? Why are they here? Yeah, you know, I think you can see, actually, this study was inside, but you know what? You know how many farms I go to, and I look at these calves, and I like grouping by the age. Why? Because this calf, all of a sudden, I look at her, and she's slightly smaller than the rest, right? And we know, because we've patterned it out on these animals, she's probably going to be an underperformer. Or I see that one in the corner, or I see that one that's getting pushed around. Right? But they still exist in our herd. Why are they there? Right? So I think it's really important that we start identifying some of these animals. So some of my herds have identified these bottom tier, bred them back to beef, and then we're using sex semen on this top 10 or 15%. There are a number of herds in the U.S., there aren't many, but there are a few where we're literally jumping a generation genetically. What would take us 10 years is maybe taking us 5 to 7 years, okay? I always love this quote. I love Warren Buffett. He makes a lot of money. He says cash is like oxygen, right? We breathe it in, we don't think about it because it's there. But when the oxygen isn't there, it's the only thing we think about. It's how cash works, right? So in cash, these are five things that I ask all my producers to do. Create a little dashboard, right? It's about predictive analytics. What can I do to predict my situation? I want all of my producers that I work with to know where their checkbook balance is at least on a monthly basis, preferably on a weekly basis, right? Here I am in October. How much did I have at the beginning of the year? Wow. Looks like the trend's going down. Looks like I'm losing about $15,000 per month cash flow. Why is that? Is that trend going to continue? Right? It's not about the value. It's about what's my trend. Operating loans. I've talked to a number of bankers here in the UK. Learned about, you know, different operating loans. Not necessarily about the balance, but how much do you have available going forward? How much capacity do we have to borrow? Payables. Oh, I love this one. So I go in and I print off the records for this period, you know, third quarter, and I'm looking. Wow, you've really cut feed cost. Wow, you've really cut breeding expense. Wow, you've really cut the vet bill. Gosh, you got to tell me what you're doing because, well, we haven't paid the feed bill for 3 months. We haven't paid the vet for 2 months. I don't remember the last time we paid the breeding expense, the semen bill. Right? So it's not just about the cash, it's about the accrual piece of it, right? How many bills are left unpaid at the end of the month that we have to address next month? Burn rate, this is something we're looking at more and more at in the US. We talked about working capital before, right? So I have $1 million of working capital, but next year I'm projected to lose $500,000. What's my burn rate? 2 years, right? If I continue to lose $500,000 every year, my working capital can carry me for 2 years. Right now I see struggling dairies in the US maybe at about 5 to 6 months, 5 to 7 months. And when you look at, because we talked about current assets, right, being cash and feed. Feed you can sell, but it's a little hard, right? We might not get cash right away. So true liquidity, cash, may only take us a month or two right now, okay? This is a good one. The secret of success is to do the common thing uncommonly well. I think Yoop's presentation hit that nail on the head, right? Margins, this is the other thing I want to get across. Margins matter. Which farm are we going to choose, A or B? A? No, B? Okay. How about which one now? Not much different, right? It's just on a per cow basis. What about now? 38 liters versus 35. How about now? Well, we're going to make a little bit more here in case B versus case A. Well, guess what? My point to this is they're almost identical, right? So what does this say? This says feed cost does not matter. Feed cost is irrelevant. It's how much am I getting over my feed cost, right? That's what matters most. That's the thing I want to drive home for you guys is when you look at your costs, it's not just an expense. It's not just a cost. What are you getting for what you're paying for? Are you getting a value? You hit it on the head. It's an investment. Every cost is an investment, right? So here's some income over feed cost margins in the United States. Average feed cost per cow per day, about 4.88 pounds per cow per day. We're looking at feed efficiency numbers, right? This is for every kilo of dry matter going into the cow, how many liters am I getting out, right? In the U.S., this range is pretty broad, 1.45 all the way up to, 1.6 in some cases, right? But really, it comes down to my income over feed cost, right? Almost 6 pounds per cow per day is what's left over for me to cover all the other expenses I need, right? Yeah, that's a good one. So how do we do that, though? Feed cost, you're right. Whoever types, doesn't matter. But what does that depend on? It depends on putting up good quality forages, because I'm going to defend the nutritionists. We ask them to do incredible things with poor quality forages sometimes, right? Admit it. Sometimes we put up really bad feed, and then we complain about our feed cost. Sometimes we need to look in the mirror, okay? We've got to put up better quality forages. Bunker management. I've been to a few dairies here. Very impressed with the facing of the silages. Very impressed. You guys do a very good job from what I've seen. Shrink. Shrink is huge. So I harvest 1,000 tons out of the field, and I track feed for the year, and I find out we only fed 850 tons. What happened to the other 150? Right? When I look at that bunker, I don't want to see any black. We have guys using oxygen barriers on the sides of the wall, coverings on top, keeping that oxygen out, right? We've got to put up and store good quality feed. Net herd replacement cost, just hit on a couple of things that I've already talked about. The banker's old adage is, how do we make more money? We'll just produce more milk. Just ship more milk, right? Higher cull value. So this is turning that dead cow or any cow and saying, you know what, she's got good body on her. We're not, she's not bred back. We're at, 70, 80 days of milk, maybe over 100 days of milk. Gonna identify her as a cull as quickly as possible so I get as much value out of her as I can, right? And limiting those 60-day early lactation removals. So a couple of last points here. Good quality financials, negotiating with vendors, maximizing cash discounts. I see this a lot. The invoice says pay by the 10th of the month. Then I look at the ledger and they paid on the 12th of the month. Two more days. If you just paid 2 days sooner, you would have gotten a 2% discount. That happens a lot. Don't miss out on the opportunities. And I'd say the last thing here, maximize existing investments. You guys have invested a lot in your business. Dairy is very capital intensive. Make sure you're getting out of it what you're putting into it, right? And I think the last comment here, capital isn't scarce. I hear this a lot. Gosh, man, if we just had a better milk price. No, you know what? I have herds that, their cost of production is comparable here in the UK. It'd be about 17 pence a liter. They're always making money. We need to compete with them. Milk price and saying capital is our problem is not good enough. Vision is what we need. Understanding where we're going and how we're going to be better in the future is key. And with that, I thank you very much. So, where do you see milk prices going over the next 10 years, and will demand outstrip supply? So a two-part question there. Where do I see? I see volatility continuing. I don't see that going away, unless you're going to be like Canadians and you put in a quota system. Yeah, then maybe there's some benefit to that, but I'm not necessarily excited about a quota system either. There's benefits to it. What's interesting in the U.S., we actually have processor induced quotas now. So I'm your processor. I'm buying milk from you, and I say, well, we're going to take the last three-year average of your milk production, and that's what I want. If you decide, well, I'm going to add 200 cows, Matt, you got to come talk to me beforehand. I think that's fair, right? In the U.S., we've always all just shoved 300 more cows through, let them pick it up, right? We've got to be better at that. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
With Brexit, we're concerned about importing beef from America that will be treated with hormones, which will put the British producer at a major disadvantage.
I fixed that problem for you. We're not using hormones anymore.
You what?
We went away from BST.
Yeah, with growth hormones of beef.
Oh, beef. Yes, beef. Okay, I follow now. I follow.
It said okay?
Yeah.
And do you still use BST? I think it was BST in for milk production, injecting cows to give them greater milk production.
Yeah, no, I follow your question. So on the BST side, that has been a huge change in the U.S. for the last 2 years now. I had about 9 or 10 herds went off of BST last year. We had one processor that said, a butter plant that said, no more BST. And every other processor cheesemaker in Wisconsin ships excess cream and whey to that butter plant. So it was like a domino effect. So I don't have but maybe two or three clients on BST anymore. I think there will be maybe one state left in the United States using BST. My prediction is within the next year or two, there won't be any more BST in the United States. Beef cattle, that's going to be a different debate. We're definitely continuing to use those. But I think with the pressure that we've seen with BST, that it may be, I would give us a little bit longer time frame, but I see us probably moving away from that as well. Because the global market doesn't want that. And if we're really going to be a player in the global market, then we have to match that. Potentially. Yep. Potentially. Meat and bone meal? Yeah, you know what? Meat and bone meal is pretty crazy price. Actually, when I look at some of the rations and what creates some short-term volatility in our feed pricing is meat and bone meal. Most of my producers, I would say, continue to use it. I don't know about that one. That would be a question I would have to ask one of the nutritionists in the U.S., how they feel about that. I don't right now see that going away. So fear of dead cows a major factor in the low average number of lactations in the U.S.? Yeah, some of that is. I think it's just burnout. Part of it is heifers, right? Heifer inventory. If I have 100 cows in the U.S., my target is about 85% or 85 heifers. Yuba's right. We've really challenged our clients to lower their age at first calving. My top clients are averaging 22 and a half to 23 and a half months age at first calving. Nothing will make you more money than reducing your average age at first calving. If you're at 27, 28 months, that's too long. It's too long. Think about it. I can reduce the total number of heifers I'm feeding, plus I'm getting her in the milk stream faster, right? We've got some feed companies that are pushing 21 months. Might be a little extreme because they might be undersized, not as mature, but I think we've got to do that. I think that's a bigger issue. Our dry cow costs, the basis for feed, is the benchmark we should use to work out how much invest in a cow for the return? I'm not sure about that one. From a dry cow standpoint, here's what I would say on that. You know, I think we do a disservice to our dry cows in the industry, right? They're usually an afterthought, and we don't put much value into them, and consequently, we wonder why we have problems in the lactation afterwards. Why? Because in the U.S., we just shove them on a pack in some cases, and we don't give them enough feed bunk space. We don't give them enough lying down space, right? Because they're costing me money. They're not making me money. But to me, they're the most important investment as far as an animal on the farm, because they're in my next milker, plus they're carrying my next generation. Right? So if I'm building a new dairy, I'm gonna work on where's my transition cow facilities first. Should dairy units invest in developing value-added production facilities? Should they do so now or wait? So I'm guessing this is referring to like milk bottling on farm, making ice cream, making cheese. So it's a growing trend in the U.S. I think it's a value-added proposition if somebody's looking at, you know, maybe they don't want to make an investment on the dairy side. Could they make an investment into some other business, like making cheese that brings greater value back to the dairy? I don't think that's a bad idea to look at. If you're a certain dairy of whatever size and you feel that meets your needs or what you want to do, it's good. But just remember, treat it like a separate business, right? We've got to treat that as a completely separate business. And what you pay the farm, you're still going to be competing with other farmstead cheese makers as well. That's what I did in my early life, is in working with farmstead cheese operations and helping from a business perspective. So I think it's worthwhile to look at. I would do it now because I think the trend is moving towards that. But you have to analyze whether that's really where you want to put the investment. Again, it's about the vision of what you have for your farm. Yes.
What would you say is the most profitable preg rate, and is it, would that percentage change yield of the hay?
Yeah, it's a very good question. So is there, I think there is a little bit of an arc of diminishing returns. You know, we do have some herds that are pushing 35% preg rates, but at the same time, what they're getting for the quality of milk and the milk production is compensating them for that higher preg rate. So I don't know that there's a point too high. There may be where we reach at some point someday, but right now I haven't seen that. So I do think that we're getting greater value as our preg rates are going up. We're definitely compensating for them. There was a second part to your question too, I think.
Is any, and does the percentage of preg rate relate to the liters of cows?
Yeah, I do believe it does. Because we've seen a number of herds that have migrated. I mean, some of my lower producing herds are 14, 15% preg rates. And we've made advancements in some of these herds, getting up to 21, 22. Some cases we're moving to 24 and 25.
When you say lower producing herd, what would that be in the U.S.?
So maybe in the 60, 70 pound range. So that would, I don't know, probably be about high 20 liters, 28, 29 liters maybe, 30 liters. And trying to get them closer to that 40 mark or 45. Yeah. So I do believe there is a strong correlation. Great.
Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Lange.
Appreciate it.